Engineering, and the resource person or the guest speaker is Professor Rajkumar Pant, sir. We will be very thankful to you, sir, for accepting our invitation very generously and taking time to deliver the lecture series and your precious time. I hope every participant should be utilizing these 2 days. This would be a wonderful experience for them. So getting a knowledge sharing with the sir, and who is acting like a guest speaker and the resource person for our lecture series. And I'd like to detail about the today's plan of schedule for the day one activities. So my dear participants, so day one activities are from 11 to 11:50, we'll be having introduction to LTS systems, and 11:50 to 12, we'll be having, and it, the session would be again from 12 to 1 o'clock, and the session two would be from 12 to 1, that it would be on the topic sizing procedure for indoor RC airships 1. And there will be a lunch break from 1 to 2. And the session 3 would start from 2 to 2:50. It starts at 2 and it's at 2:50. So where the topic would be sizing procedure for indoor RC airships 2. And there will be a bio break from 2:50 to 3. And the session would start from 3 o'clock exactly, where the session 4 is about overview of previous indoor airship projects. Overview of previous indoor airship projects. So this is what a total day one schedule. So with this short introduction about sir, so I'm not taking much time of sir time, because the sir time is very valuable for us. So we'd like to utilize that time. So for that reason only, I'm giving a very short introduction about Rajkumar Pant sir. And if time is allowed, so I'd like to talk about a 1 hour about sir only, but even the participants' time is very important for us. So with this short introduction, I request Rajkumar Pant sir to take the session. And I hand over this session to Rajkumar Pant sir. With permission from our HOD sir and Rajkumar Pant sir, I'd like to give this session to sir.
Okay, thank you so much.
Rajkumar
sir. Yeah, we can start now. It's exactly 11.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So, a very good morning to everyone. To this 2 day lecture series. I believe that many of you are already having some exposure on lighter than air or LTS systems, and because you are undergoing a course on this topic. So what we have done is we made a slight change, because we are going to talk only about airships. Therefore, I have reduced the introductory portion and I'll be talking only about airships. And then we will go ahead with the other things as mentioned. So without any delay, let us start. So to the students of Sandeep University, my request is that we would like this session to be as interactive as possible. So therefore, please feel free. Now I'm not able to see any hands raised or anything. So you just have to unmute yourself and start speaking if you have any doubt, okay? I'm very happy to be interrupted, because that shows that you are actually paying attention to what I'm saying. So let me start with one question. You must have seen many photographs and many images of airships. I'm also starting with a PPT like that. Can you tell me quickly, anybody in the audience, what is special about these pictures? Can you guess?
So, they do have wings.
Yes. Sorry?
They don't have wings.
That is okay. That is, we know about airship that they don't have wings. Something else. Something special about these photographs.
So they are lighter than aircraft.
That is understood. The whole workshop is about that. Yes?
They are power steerable.
See, don't talk about airships. Talk about these photographs. There is something unique and special about these photographs.
So these are aerostats? All are aerostats?
None of them is an aerostat.
Okay.
This whole workshop is only about airships. That's why I have removed aerostat portion. None of them is an aerostat. They are all airships.
So they are expected to be smaller and to be controlled by remote?
My friend, I'm not asking you about airships. I'm asking you about these photographs. Okay, let me tell you. You're not able to get it.
The aerodynamic shape?
No. You are talking about airships, not about these photographs. Let me tell you, these are all photographs of airships made in IIT Bombay by students like you. That is unique about them. These are not from internet. They are not somebody else's photographs. These are airships made by students like you and researchers of our lab. So therefore, these are all our own airships. Okay. Now, as you know, there are three types of conventional LTA systems. LTA, you know, stands for lighter than air. I'm going to use it very extensively. Correct? So, hot air balloon, aerostat, and airship. So, you can see, for example, that hot air balloon basically just works on hot air to get buoyancy. It has no directional control. It just goes where the wind takes it. The aerostat has a cable which is attached from the envelope to the ground control station. It is unpowered. It only has stabilizing surfaces. But on the extreme left is the airship, which is powered as well as it has directional control. So today we are going to remove aerostats and hot air balloons from our radar, and we will focus only on airships today and tomorrow. So typically, just like any aircraft, there are four forces acting on the airship: lift, thrust, weight, and drag. Now, two of these forces are natural and two of these forces are made by us. So, which are the two forces which are natural? Can someone tell me?
So, weight and drag.
Weight and drag, weight and height are natural forces. Lift and thrust are to be created by us. In the case of airships, we don't even have to worry about lift because it gets created due to the buoyancy of the gas filled inside the envelope. So even lift becomes a natural force, and this natural force is a function of the enclosed volume of the envelope and also on the buoyancy of the gas inside. So on the bottom, you will see the only formula that you will see in my presentation today. Remaining is only going to be pictures and videos and photos, etc. So the buoyant lift LB is equal to the volume of the envelope V into the difference in the density between the ambient air outside and the gas inside. So if you want to increase the lift because you want to carry more, so how will you calculate the payload capacity of an airship if you know the value of LB? How will you calculate how much load the airship can carry?
Force is equal to rho gv.
So are you saying that you can carry lift, you can carry a payload of rho into g into v, rho g into v? Is that what you are saying, that you can carry a payload equal to rho g into v? No, that is not true. If you know that the lifting capacity of buoyant lift LB is equal to V into density difference, how will you calculate how much payload you can carry? What is meant by payload, do you know? Someone please tell me, what is meant by payload in any aircraft?
So the extra carrier weight other than which we can lift with our aircraft.
Other than the self weight, correct?
Yes, sir.
So from the buoyant lift LB, if you subtract the self weight, what will you get?
Lifting capacity.
Lifting capacity. And you can use the entire lifting capacity for payload, but then you'll have no margin at all. You might say 80% of the lifting capacity I will use for carrying payload, and 20% I will keep for something else. Or you might say 90%. It's up to you. Correct? Okay. So, just like an aircraft, airships also has some components. Okay. Now, let me give you some idea about this airship. Of course, I'll talk about it in the evening, so I'll not talk about it now. So, like an aircraft has got wings which generate the major lift, an airship has an envelope which is full of the LTA gas that generates the lift. Then there is a gondola on the bottom, in which normally you put all your payload and all the other things that you are carrying in the airship, including in this case, the power plant. and on the back, you have these four control surfaces. So now let us look at the similarities and the differences between airships and aircraft, fixed wing aircraft. So can you please tell me what are the differences based on this photograph? Difference between an aircraft and an airship looking at the photograph. Come on, guys, we don't have infinite time. We have only 50 minutes, and that too, you know, if we spend so much time in the introductory portion, it will be difficult to complete.
Compared to aircraft, airship has extra control surface.
Very good observation. I am very happy, Shubham. I'm extremely happy that you observed that in an airship, we have four control surfaces, two vertical and two horizontal. In the aircraft, you have only one vertical and two horizontal. Okay. Can you tell me the reason, Shubham? Why do we need four surfaces for an airship? Whereas three are okay for the aircraft? Yes, no problem.
What is the guess? I don't know.
Yeah, if you don't know, you guess. You say, I don't know, but I would like to guess. Okay. Anybody else would like to try?
Maybe those are less effective than aircraft.
Very good. Why are they less effective? You are right. Why are they less effective?
Sir, because the speed will be slow. So therefore, exactly. We need...
Very good. Very good, Arup. Arup, thank you so much. So, you are right, Arup, because the speed at which airships fly is not as compared to the aircraft. Therefore, you need larger area for the control and stabilizing surfaces. Okay, both stabilizing also and controlling also. And if you make only one surface on the top, it is going to become very large and flexible. And even the envelope is also generally flexible. Of course, there are many types of airships. We'll see in the next few slides. So yes, that is the reason why airships need larger number of control surfaces and stabilizing surfaces. So we have four. Very good. Okay. Any other observation compared to aircraft?
Sir, it has a huge envelope, unlike aircrafts.
Exactly. So, in the aircraft, the gondola, which carries the passengers, payloads, etc., etc., that is actually the fuselage, and that is larger than the wing in size generally. Correct? But in the case of airships, the gondola is so small compared to the large envelope. Excellent. And of course, a young lady mentioned in the beginning that there are no wings. Yes, that is also true. Because airships don't need wings because they generate lift by buoyancy. Now, my question to you is, do airships generate lift only by buoyancy, or is there some other mechanism also? Do airships generate lift only by buoyancy?
Sir, gas filling it.
Yeah, gas filling is buoyancy only, my friend. Gas filling is buoyancy only. Other than the gas filling, or other than the buoyancy, is there any other way airships can get lift?
With the help of control surface?
No, control surfaces don't give lift even in the aircraft. They only give moment. They only give a moment to cancel either destabilizing moment or to create a desired control moment. So tell me one thing. Right now you are seeing the airship flying. Can you see some ropes hanging below it? They are not very clear, but are you able to see in the image? There are some small ropes which are hanging below the airship. Can you see them?
Yes, sir.
So are they vertical or are they having some inclination?
Inclination.
What does it mean? Is the airship stationary or flying forward or backward?
Flying forward.
Correct. So when this airship flies forward, and you can also see there is an angle also, isn't it? You can guess the direction of the wind by the parallel lines of these handling lines, and you can make out that the airship is at some angle. So that means there is some angle of attack between the envelope and the ambient wind. So what will happen if a body like this flies at an angle of attack in the wind?
Sir, as it has a large body, the drag forces will be more.
No, no. Don't talk of negative things first. Talk of a positive thing first. Will there be any lift acting on it? Or let us say, see, lift and drag are only components of forces. Will there be any normal reaction? Will there be any reaction acting on this body as it flies in the air? Or will there be no forces and movements on the body when it is flying in the air? So a cylindrical bluff body is moving in the air at some angle of attack. Will there be any forces acting on it?
Lift force.
No, not only lift force. So there will be a normal reaction acting on it, and that when we take into components along and normal to the ambient relative wind, we call it a lift and drag forces. So some additional lift will be acting on this airship as it moves forward. That lift is called as dynamic lift, and the lift which is coming because of buoyancy, even when it is stationary, that is called as static lift. Okay, so airships have two kinds of lift: buoyant lift, which is maybe 80%, 90%, and dynamic lift, which will be 15-20% generally. Okay, right. So we look at types of airships. There are four basic types of airships. There is a rigid airship where the entire framework outside and inside is rigid, and then you have some gas bags in which you keep the LTA gas. This is a very old technology, and this is not generally used today, although there are some people who are trying to revive this technology back. But generally today you don't see rigid airships flying. The other extreme is a non-rigid airship in which there is no structural member inside. The shape is maintained purely by internal overpressure. Yes, there are some ropes, etc., inside which are there to transfer the load, but there is no solid structural element inside. Then we have an in between these two called as semi-rigid. So, does anybody know about semi-rigid airships? You are doing a course on LTA systems. Can you tell me the difference between rigid, non-rigid, and semi-rigid?
Rigid are fixed to ground. Semi-rigid are tied with the rope to the ground. And
No. I'm sorry. Rigid is not fixed to ground. Rigid. What will it do if it is fixed to ground? Then it is useless. It has to fly. So right now it is attached to the ground because people are supposed to land, or maybe there is some maintenance work going on. But it's not. This slide is about the structural configuration.
Sir, the envelope will be supported by some internal structures in rigid airship.
Okay, so envelope is supported by some internal rigid structure in rigid airships.
Yes,
that's what you are saying, na? Okay. So what about what you see? The outer structure, is that rigid or non-rigid? In a rigid airship, let me just remove the other photographs. In the rigid airship, there is an internal structure. I agree with you completely. But what about the outer structure?
It's rigid too.
It's rigid too. And do you see a gondola here?
No, sir.
But there is something in the front of the bottom. What is that? I mean, if I take my mouse somewhere here, can you see my mouse?
Yes, yes, sir.
What is that?
Sir, maybe it's a gondola for the controlling of the...
Correct, correct. Very right. That is basically a cockpit. And this has to be outside the airship because pilots have to see. Okay, so where are the passengers sitting in this airship? They are sitting inside the airship. The passengers are sitting inside the airship. Okay, so the passenger cabin, like a fuselage, is inside the structure. And the outside structure is rigid. So everything is rigid here, and there are gas bags inside. In this case, nothing is rigid inside. So there are no passengers inside. The passengers are sitting in the gondola below, and the pilot is in the front. So what is happening in semi-rigid then?
Tied with rope to the ground.
No, my friend, all airships are supposed to fly and all airships are tied with the rope to the ground. So don't go by a tying with the rope on the ground. Tell me about the structural configuration. This question is about structure. How is the structure of semi-rigid airship?
The sitting arrangement both in a gondola or in airship.
So, do you think that the sitting arrangement is inside the airship? No, not in this case. So, here nobody is sitting inside the airship. They are all sitting in the gondola. But you can see them. I can see one red t-shirt. So, like the non-rigid airship, they are sitting in the gondola below the airship. There is nobody inside the airship. So then what is inside the airship?
Some internal structure for support.
So if there is an internal structure for support, then it is a rigid airship. Then why do you call it semi-rigid?
Internal gas.
Gas is also there in the rigid airship. I told you there are gas bags. You need to have buoyant gas bags inside. So, if the semi-rigid airship has an internal structure and the people are sitting outside in the bottom, then what is the difference between semi-rigid and non-rigid?
There may be not internal structure, only the gas is there.
So, if there is no structure inside, then it is non-rigid. Then why semi-rigid?
Sir, it has both rigid and non-rigid characteristics. It will have structures to support the envelope as well as the gas pressure inside.
And what about the outer covering? In the rigid airship, we had a rigid covering. So in semi-rigid, what is the covering?
The covering will be somewhat like non-rigid structure, sir.
That's right. So, it is called semi-rigid because neither it is fully rigid, neither it is non-rigid. It is in between. So, what is in between? Do you see the blue line on the bottom? Okay. On the bottom half of the airship, there is some blue colored line. And can you tell me in the non-rigid airship, where is the engine?
Sir, within the, behind of the cockpit, sir.
No, not cockpit, gondola. See, there are three things there. Yes, cockpit, sir. Is in gondola. The front. There is a passenger cabin or a gondola. Yeah. So, in the case of non-rigid airship, the engine is mounted on the gondola. In this case, on the gondola rear side. Okay. Where is the engine in the case of rigid airships? You cannot see it, but you see there are these four things you can see. It's actually mounted outside the airship. Okay. It's not very clear because the photograph is very old. So 1, 2, 3, 4 and on that side. Okay, where is the engine mounted in the semi-rigid airship?
Sir, maybe back side.
Yeah, you can see on the back side there is one engine, very right. So you can mount an engine on the back side of a semi-rigid airship because there is some structure available there. Okay. Anywhere else you see an engine? Do you see another engine in this airship, semi-rigid airship? There is one engine here also on the side, which was not very clear to you probably. So that's why you could not guess it. And this engine is tilted upwards. So that is the beauty of semi-rigid. Because there is a structure inside, you can mount the engine on the envelope and not on the gondola. And finally, we have a hot air airship. This is a hot air balloon, but the shape is like an airship. Okay? So these are the four kinds of airships, and we are going to work on non-rigid airship. Right. So you have all heard about Hindenburg?
Yes, sir.
What do you?
Professor Pant online?
I think no.
No, the feed is gone. The video feed is gone.
Yeah, I think network issue. Sir, you are on mute.
Yeah, sorry. There was a problem with the internet on my side. So that's why we lost it. Now I'm going to connect to you again. I am now on the phone internet, so there may be a slight issue. Normally, we don't have any internet problem in IIT, but sometimes it does happen. So we go back to our presentation. Okay. So we are back. So tell me about Hindenburg. What do you know about Hindenburg? I think I'm going to skip this. I'm going to skip this because let me just come back to the revival of airships. Okay. So let me show you some modern airships. Okay, this is a modern manned airship. There was somebody who began talking about Hindenburg. Can you please tell me?
Sir, it was an accident which was famous in the case of airships.
Is that all you know about Hindenburg?
Yes, I just know. I read an article that it caught fire and there was a disaster during the docking of the airship. That's all right. I know, sir. Okay. Fine.
So what you know about Hindenburg is that it caught fire and there was a disaster. Okay. Let me tell you something about Hindenburg that you don't know. Hindenburg was the largest airship ever built and launched in 1936. Okay. It had 16 bags of hydrogen. It could travel 10,000 miles continuously 5 to 6 days. At a cruise speed of around 80 kilometers per hour. It could cross the Atlantic Ocean in about 50 to 60 hours. And before the accident, it had completed successfully 10 round trips from Germany to USA. All this was in 1936. And before that, when the fixed wing aircraft were struggling to actually perform. There was nothing available at that time which could fly so much, such a large distance. The disaster took place in 1937. What you know is that 35 people died. What you don't know is that 62 people survived. That means nearly the double of the people who died, the other people survived. Now, please tell me, how many accidents about fixed-wing aircraft you know in which the aircraft catches fire while coming into land and 62 people survive? Okay. This is the information regarding Hindenburg which is not popularized. What is popularized about Hindenburg is this, that it caught fire, there was an accident, airships are unsafe. And that is why there was a hibernation of airship from 1936 onwards. After 37, there were two more accidents. One was in the UK with an airship called as RH-101. Incidentally, it was coming to India from London and it caught fire somewhere near Paris. And then the next accident took place in USA. After that, everybody thought airships are dangerous, airships are unsafe. But they were revived in 1985 by this airship called as Skyship 600B. Now I'll show you a short video of today, how the airships are. So what I want you to do is, I want you to notice, first of all, the location of this airship operation. I want you to count the number of people on the ground, and I want you to look at the airship, how it is operated. Can you see the video, please confirm?
Yes, sir, you can see.
Look at the engine being tilted upwards. Location is a ground near the highway. This is not an airport. This is a simple ground near a highway. There is no requirement for a runway takeoff length, landing distance. It is a pure vertical takeoff and landing aircraft. Three engines, one on the back and two on the sides. This is the modern airship that is flying today. Okay, whenever we talk about any particular system, we talk about what is called as a USP. What is the meaning of USP? Anybody can tell me what is meant by USP? What is the meaning of the word USP? If you don't know, do a Google search and tell me.
Sir, unique selling proposition.
Very right. USP stands for unique selling proposition. What is unique about airships as compared to other aircraft? So the list is there in front of you. Do you have any questions or any clarification on these points?
So no clarification required.
Okay, let's go ahead and then let me show you some of these applications now. These are the existing application of airships in the order of importance. All over the world, airships are mostly used for advertisement and product promotion. The next application is aerial observation and surveillance, and then other applications. So here is an example of airships for advertisement and product promotion. Okay. This is an example of aerial observation. This particular airship was flying in Las Vegas. It had, I think, 4 or 6 seats. And you could be on the airship as a tourist to look at Las Vegas by air. Tourism. This is the gondola of the airship which I showed you. It has 12 seats, I think. So let me show you a small video clip. Kindly confirm to me when the video starts that you can see. I don't think you can see. I think you cannot see. Right? So I'm going to directly do it from the... I think there is a problem, so I'll directly go. I'll directly go to the folder where it is there and show you from there. Let me do one thing. Let me try to share. If I share the entire screen, it should work. But somehow it's not working. Can you see now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Very good. Okay. So I'm going to show you now. This is the beauty of flying in an airship. You can use it for covering sports events without disturbing the animals below. You can use it for what is called as corporate hospitality, in which the entire team of around 10, 12 people can be made to travel up in the air and just go around. But there are also some very interesting applications. One of them is the usage of airships for anti-mining operations. Okay, so you can fit a sensor like in this. On the right hand side, you see there is one special camera fitted on the front of the airship. Can you see that? This big round white thing.
Yes, sir.
This is the special sensor which is sensing any metallic objects buried inside the ground. And from that, you can identify the landmines. So I'll show you a small video of how it is done.
As patrons.
It's an extraordinary technology. But right now there's something of 70 million landmines out there. People are being hurt daily. We're not really sure exactly where they are. And instead of the what has now become an antiquated technique of searching them out with metal detectors or dogs, this is an extraordinary technology that is able to monitor hundreds of square meters a second and define exactly where and what kind of landmines are there, and which will lead to a much quicker removal. So it's an extraordinary technology. Right now it's just sitting on a shelf and it needs to be put into action, and that's why we're here.
We as a group have decided we're going to get the funding. We have people standing by that will fund mine seekers and our equipment and our technology and getting the first vehicle actually in the air, floating in the air. Our goal is, I believe, to make 6 or 7 of these and have them in various parts of the world. And if for any reason everything else fails, every hairdresser, every friend, probably half the flight people on Virgin Airlines, and everybody we know will make a contribution. But we are dedicated to getting this done, and we are very certain we have the financial means to be able to do that without relying on politics to get it done. But we need political help, obviously, once we're in the country with groups that will help remove them.
Okay. So could you understand? You can scan on the ground and then you can identify mines. Any questions?
No, sir.
Sir.
Yeah. Yes.
What distance it scan means ground to airship?
So it flies very low. As you can see, there is a sensor, and that sensor has to be so. That is the beauty. You can even fly a few feet above the ground and still not have any problem. So it flies very low, because the lower you fly, the better is the accuracy of determination.
Okay, sir.
Anything else? So I'll go ahead. Another application of airships is the surveillance or used by security agencies. In many Olympic Games, airships have been used for aerial security. So I'll show you one example of the Olympics in 2012 in Tokyo, I think. I'll just show you a time-lapse video. So what I want you to do is, I'll go a little bit fast to save time. So do you see one airship flying in the air? Yes or no?
Sir,
yes, sir.
So what is it doing? It's continuously flying in circles. Okay? Because somewhere here is the stadium. There is a stadium here. So it is just flying in circles, keeping an eye on the stadium. Okay, this is a high-speed video. Okay, so now it is evening time. This is the stadium, the center. Can you see the stadium? There are some lights there.
Yes, sir.
So where is the airship? The airship is here. It's flying. Correct? Now it becomes a bit dark. The airship is still flying. Some ceremonies are going on. The airship is still flying. You can see one white colored patch in the sky. Right?
Yes, sir.
So something is going on. Something is going on. Now some events have started. There is some kind of inaugural ceremony. So a lot of lights are there. Okay. Where is the airship? The airship is still in the sky, but you can't see it. Suddenly you will see one flash. When you see a flash, you will see the airship in the sky. So it seems that there is nothing in the sky, but actually there is an airship in the sky monitoring the things.
Sir, what is the maximum endurance time for airship?
Very good question. So if you want to fly like this continuously over a stadium, right from the afternoon to the evening, okay, 1 minute. There is some festivities. Let us just see. Yeah, you can see. Some festivities took place. But if you see in the flash, you will see there is an airship in the sky. So, you can see now the airship?
Yes.
She's there. So, you can fly an airship nonstop like this for about 8 to 9 hours. Okay. But the world record for an airship is 52 hours nonstop flight. That is why airships, the best thing they can do is fly very quietly without much pollution, without much noise, without much vibration for a long duration of time. Okay? Right. So now I'm open to any queries. All your questions regarding airships, I would like you to ask. I have about 7 minutes time. Then we will take a short break. And then I will also like to introduce you to some of the people who will be helping me in conducting this workshop. So friends, you have time now for any query regarding airships or LTA systems. Loudly, please.
Sir, you build one airship. What is the size of this?
Which airship?
Sarina, IIT Bombay. Yes, sure.
IIT Bombay airship, the largest one I have built is around 15. So I'll show you that also. The one which I have, largest one I have built is the white one, which is around 15. 8 meters.
8 meters
in length.
Okay.
But we have made one aerostat of 100 meter cube also. That was a little bit larger, but airship only maximum 8 meters. Okay, questions about IIT Bombay airships, you can ask in the last session today, because that is only for IIT Bombay airships. This session is mainly about airships in general. Any query regarding airships in general?
So what kind of material used in IIT Bombay airships?
That I will answer in the evening, madam. I want to answer questions about non-IIT Bombay airships.
Okay, sir.
Sir, can you please explain the propulsion techniques in rigid airships? Because it was not clear, sir, that time.
See, in the rigid airship, there are some engines which are attached to the structure hanging outside. So there are four engines here, and there are four engines there. And in this case, they were all piston prop engines. See, you have a structure right from the front to the back. You have an inside structure. You have an outside structure. So you can actually mount the engine roughly anywhere. There is no problem in rigid airships to mount the engine.
Yes, sir.
Other questions?
Sir, what is the maximum speed of latest airships?
About 100 kilometers per hour. Approximately 100 kilometers per hour is the maximum speed of modern day airships. Passenger carrying airships. Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Sir, how much cost for one airship?
How much cost for one airship?
Yes.
So
sir.
So this Zeppelin NT airship. I had taken some estimate in the year 2003. It was coming to around $6 million. Okay, in 2003. Today, I don't know. I'll have to just check online, or I'll have to ask the company. But they are very expensive because they are very special. They are unique. Very few are available. But they are very costly.
Sir, in a rigid airship, the engine used for lifting purpose or controlling?
No, the engine is used for giving forward thrust. The tails are, you can see there are huge vertical tail and horizontal tail. And there is also a rudder and elevator. They are used for control and stability. Engine is used only for forward motion. The engine is not swivelable in many rigid airships. But in the case of non-rigid airship that you are seeing here, the engine is swivelable. And also, Zeppelin NT also, the engine is swivelable.
Okay,
sir. Which type of sensors are used in airships?
Sensors. So, there are a large number type of sensors. Sensing for what purpose? When you say sensors, what do you mean? For what purpose? Do you mean instruments in the cockpit?
Yes, sir.
They are same like a small, low-speed aircraft. Any aircraft that flies at 70, 80 kilometers per hour maximum speed, that kind of instrumentation is there in the cockpit. So you have the same things. Okay, let me show you a small video then. I have a video. I have a video of this. Oh, I removed it. Sorry. I did not have the time, so I removed it. But what I will do is I will try to show the video. I'll try to show the video. Are you able to see my video?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Wait a minute. That's why.
March 6, 1984. For the first time, Skyship 600 has emerged from her hangar at the Royal Air.
Yes, sir, we can see.
Hardington, the traditional shrine of British airship aviation.
This is 1985.
Mark has the latest generation of lighter than aircraft, designed and built by Airship Industries and packed with state of the art aviation technology.
He is the pilot.
The world's media were out in force to witness the 600's maiden flight, reflecting the global interest in this multi-purpose craft. The 600 is a stretched version of the earlier Skyship 500, with passenger capacity doubled from 10 to 20 seats, cruising speed increased to 55 knots, airborne endurance to a remarkable
55 knots, 48
hours, and virtually every other aspect of the craft refined and upgraded.
Thanks, crew of the Vectors.
Little bit old.
Minute number one.
Because of 1985.
Minute number two.
Satisfied with the running of the twin turbocharged Porsche engines, Chief Test Pilot Commander Nick Bennett was now ready for takeoff.
You can see the engine is swiveling. The engine is swiveling.
Using only a low power setting, and now the 600 executed a perfect zero-roll takeoff and climbed steeply and quietly into the sky. She had...
Okay. Right. Okay. So now we are at 11:50. I have promised to give a 10-minute break so that you can just freshen up, have a glass of water, etc. And we will start the next session, which will be the sizing procedure for indoor airships. We will start that at 11:51, at 12 o'clock sharp. Okay. So I'm going to